أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت، وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. السلام عليك يا أبا صالح المهدي، عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. My dearest brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity to gather, a gathering of believers, as we read in the hadith of Al-Kisa, is a blessed gathering. And if any good is going to come from a believer's life, it's a blessing that will come in congregation with other believers as well. And hence we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity to gather, to remember the life, the martyrdom, the legacy of the Holy Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salatu wassalam, his companions, his progeny, and more importantly, to link that with the Imam of our time, may Allah hasten his reappearance. What I want to do tonight, inshallah, the time that we do have, and perhaps extend it tomorrow and Sunday night, is to pose a very important question. Today or yesterday, having marked the 40th day after the martyrdom of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, for many of us, and rightly so, it marks a checkpoint or a transitionary point, that what was done and what began for many of us in the first of Muharram, the cycle is now coming to an end. And traditionally, historically, for many and perhaps for most, the cycle of the remembrance of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, his companions, his martyrdom, the grief, the sorrow, all of that is generally defined in this 40-day period. Now, if we are going to set that at least as a checkpoint, then tomorrow, or today having been the 41st day, marks a new beginning and the start of a new cycle in the relationship and the conduct that we have with this important tradition and this important legacy. So the question that must be asked today, and what we'll try to reflect upon in some of the a'mal, some of the rituals that we've done on days like this, is what is it that a person is supposed to do now? And to answer this question correctly, a reflection and an assessment must be done of what was accomplished in this cycle. So in the 40 days that we came, we remembered, we listened, we cried, we gave, and for many on a day like this, they're spending it in close proximity to the Holy Imam in Karbala. What was the conclusion of all of that? Of course, the answer to this for every person will be different. The point here is not to provide an answer that is meant to satisfy the experience of all people. Each one of us have different lived experiences. Yes, there are messages, there are general meanings that are supposed to be derived and experienced in this cycle, but the point is not to say that this is what a person should have done, and if they haven't done that, then they should deem their experience a failure. No, that's not true. But what is important to do is for every person to have a personal assessment of what has been the reality of the experience in this 40 days. And what we've done today or yesterday in the A'mal of Arba'een, what are we saying here? What sort of statements have been made specifically in the Ziyarah of Arba'een? How does that compare to the statements we made on the day of Ashura? And how is that supposed to contrast with the statements that we will be making from today onwards? This is very important to do, because one of the qualities and characteristics of a believer is to be truthful in their speech and to not say things that they themselves don't practice. Now, each and every one of us have our own faults and our own deficiencies. We have shortcomings. The idea is not to think that in the Islamic experience, a person has to fit themselves into a binary of whether good or bad. No. A gradation is, of course, set. And to find where you are on this scale and to assess where you were and where you shall be is extremely important. So the Day of Arba'een and the ziyara that is done on the Day of Arba'een, so the ziyara is of one of two types. One is a dua of sorts that we recite. It doesn't have to be in close proximity to the grave of the Imam. A person can recite from afar. And interestingly, the ziyara that is done on the Arba'een of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam is unique and exclusive to him. No other Imam, to the knowledge that I have, has been prescribed a ziyara to be recited by the mu'mineen, the believers, save Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. So this is one thing that requires a little bit more study and attention. Now you may say, of course, well, his experience was different than all other Imams. Yes, all of the Imams were martyred, but his experience was unique to him. Okay, that's fine, but it doesn't seem to be enough. So on the 40th day, the first visitation that is narrated to have happened to the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, and we continue that tradition, is of course by the great companion of the Holy Prophet and the great companions of the Imam, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. Of course, we're all familiar with this. And we've all heard the story of what Jabir does. Now, historically, if we have a study, and I think it's important to do that, I was thinking about presenting this tonight as the main topic of my presentation, but I thought perhaps it may be a little too dry to just present the history of what happened. But it's important to read the history of the visitation of Jabir, number one. Number two, whether he actually meets with the Ahlul Bayt on their way back from Damascus, and what he does and says there. Because there are different narrations, and there are at least two main camps here, of the return of the Ahlul Bayt from Damascus now. Do they come and visit Karbala on the first Arba'een or do they not? Again, there are different reports and there are two main camps. Each of them have strong arguments. And there isn't really a conclusive, conclusion that a person can come to by studying that history. But it's important for it to be studied anyways. So that's something that's, that task has been given to each and every one of you to read and study that if you haven't. And if you have to restudy that and revisit that, to try to extract new lessons from that. In any case, Jabir ibn Abdullah comes on the 40th day of the death of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, his martyrdom, and he visits Imam Hussein. So I just want to read a few of the passages of the experience he has now with the companion that follows him. Jabir, I don't have to speak about his position in the Islamic tradition. He is one of the most venerated companions of the Holy Prophet. And he lived an extremely long life. Imagine to be alive during the time of the Prophet. They say he lived about 100 years. So he comes to visit the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, and he comes with a companion by the name of Atiyya al-Awfi. So he says, this is now being narrated from Atiyya. He says that Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari and myself, we went to visit the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. When we arrived close to that area, Jabir first goes to the river of the Euphrates. He says, I have to perform ghusl. Now, this is one of the etiquettes of the ziyarah that inshallah, I'll make a small point that's found in hadith. It's extremely important to understand and live the etiquette of how a person presents themselves in the presence of the imam. Extremely important. One of those is ghusl. Not that Jabir needed to do a ghusl, but the ghusl itself purifies him to engage in an activity that requires a deeper level of purification. So the ghusl is now done, and then he requests from Atiyya, says, take me close to the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. So he takes him, at that time Jabir of course had lost his sight, so he was blind. So he takes him close to the grave, and Jabir feels a sense and an aroma as he's getting close. Once he's there, Atiyya tells him this is the grave of Hussein. He throws himself and throws his body onto the grave, and he cries so much, in hadith that's narrated, he cries so much that he becomes unconscious. Now this is again, it's a behavior that is seen in many of these strong companions and strong awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means the people who truly understand, have a higher and deeper understanding or ma'rifah, gnosis, of the imam, their position, and the action that they're engaging in. In many cases, it leads to them becoming unconscious as a result of the engagement of that activity. It doesn't always have to be crying or grief, but engaging with that activity many times results in them losing the capability of their physical faculties. Atiyah says that now that he passes out from the extent of his crying, I have to wake him up, and in doing so, I have to sprinkle water on his face so that he comes to. When he comes to, now Jabir is continuing to cry and he laments this call of and shu'ar of Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein three times. So we have this in hadith as well, and not to put ourselves on the spot, but it's almost like a point where we can try and compare where we are and where we should be. It's in hadith that if a believer hears the name of Hussein recited three times, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, and a tear doesn't come to his eye, then that person should reflect on the state of their belief. So where we want to be, inshallah, in this process of engaging is to a point where we can also engage with the Imam when we perform our ziyarat the same way that Jabir does now when he visits Imam Hussein. Now he says he saw him as a child. Yes, he did. He's observed him with his perceptive faculties. We haven't. But the love that's in the heart is shared. So that's where we want to try and be. When we do engage with our Imams, when we do the ziyarah, when we're going to remember their sacrifice and remember their martyrdom, we are hoping that we can arrive at a sensitivity that when we simply hear the name of our beloved recited, it changes us internally and instantaneously. That's where we need to be. And here the point is not just how quickly can I get myself to cry. I think the point here is that how quickly can I change my emotional state and my mental state with simply the mentioning and the recitation of a name or of an idea. This is the important point here. That if you replace now the name of Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam with any divine principle, any divine meaning, can it with only three mentions of that result in us completely changing the state of our emotion and the state of our being? That we engage with that so strongly that it results in something like this. So this is almost a training ground. If we are able to connect with the true meaning, the truth of what Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam is really, and what follows is what he did, the action is less important than the person themselves. The action leads us to the essence of the truth of that person. If we're able to connect through his action to his truth, and through his truth to the truth of the absolute and ultimate truth that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with even mention of anything that relates to Allah, that is divine, three mentions will be sufficient for the believer to have a change of heart instantaneously and for them to be ready to respond to a call that is ever present, but only can be understood to the hearer, to the ear that is listening and can hear that call. So Jabir hears the call. Now, even in the engagement that Jabir has, in the record says Jabir calls on Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Says, I don't hear a response. And he begins to explain why that is. And of course, I won't hear a response because this is what happened and this is what they did to you. Now, in the final statements that Jabir is making in the presence of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, he makes a very profound statement. So I'll just share a small part of that. He says, I bear witness that you were steadfast in your prayers and gave the zakat, and you commanded the good and forbidden the evil, and struggled against the deniers of the religion, and you worshipped Allah until conviction came to you. So this is a statement that we all are making, and we continue to make, not only in the recitation of Ziyarat al-Ashura, but also in Ziyarat al-Arba'in, and many Ziyarats that we have of our Imams, we are saying these things. I bear witness that you were that, you did that. Now, what follows is extremely profound. I swear by the one who sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a prophet with truth, surely we participated with you in what you encountered. Now, Atiyah here is a little lost and shocked. He understood the statements prior to this final statement. He questioned Jabir. He said, Jabir, I don't understand the meaning of the statement that you're making. It's an extremely profound one. And only a person like Jabir who understands really not only the position of the Ahlul Bayt, but because he is so close to the Sunnah of the Prophet and the Sunnah of the Ahlul Bayt, he's able to understand really the reality of what's happened. So Atiyah says that, how is it possible? Look at all that happened to Imam Hussein and his companions. We did not descend any valley. We did not climb any mountains. We did not fight with our swords. The heads of the companions and of their leader, Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, was separated and put atop the spears. Their children were made orphans. Their women were taken captive. None of that happened to us. We didn't experience any of that. Is it fair for us to now equate our experience with their experience? This is a very important question. Many of us, through a deep sense of love that we have for the experience of the Imam and the companions, and again, I'm not saying this is incorrect, what we sometimes try and do is to demarcate what they did, what they experienced, and make exclusive that only for them. Now, no one is saying that any sorrow, any plight, any difficulty, any trial is equal in merit or in degree to that of the Imam and his companions. No. But can the essence of that be equal? That means, can there be a struggle that in essence, in meaning, is tantamount to that of the struggle of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam? Yes. Because if we're not able to make that connection, then there will be a division for sure. So Jabir says, we were with you. Atiyah says, how is that possible? Jabir responds, Atiyah, I heard from my beloved, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family. Whosoever loves a nation, they will be resurrected with them. So love right now is at the center point here. And whosoever loves the deed of a nation will be considered one who has participated in that deed with them. And I swear by one who sent the Holy Prophet as a prophet in truth, surely my intention and the intention of my companions is according to the intention of Al-Husayn alayhi salatu wasalam and his companions. So Jabir here, the profound statement that he's making is a statement that is backed up by the certainty that he has in his own intentions and his own actions. So because he is so certain of where he is coming from, he can put himself in that position as well and say, I was with them because the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, told me. If I truly love here now, if I truly love a nation and the action of a nation, I will be with them, I will be resurrected with them. So the central concept here in trying to contrast the relationship and the experience that we share with the Imam and his companions has to be questioned and examined in these two arenas. Number one, what is the level of love that a person has with his Imam and the Shuhada? Number two, how certain am I of the intention that I have in following suit in the legacy of the Imam? And do my actions also reflect that pure intention? So these are two reflection points. And this is something that is constantly being brought to the forefront in this cycle of 40 days, more than other times of the year. Why? Because every night we're being reminded, what? Of that nation, of that action, and in every stage, in great detail, we are taught. And the reason we are taught in great detail is that we are then afforded more insofar as inspiration and insofar as finding some sort of sympathy and connection that we have in our position and the position of the Imam. Now, there's a very famous hadith in Rawayah that we have that instructs us as mu'mineen. Of course, it happens in the form of instructing one of the companions. Many of the teachings that we have from the Imams comes through the channel of a close companion, and of a companion that is worthy of receiving such a message. In this case now, it comes from the channel of Abu Shabib or Ibn Shabib, one of the companions of the Imams, Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam. He tells him, Ya ibn Shabib, a lengthy hadith, says, Ya ibn Shabib, إن كنت باكيا لشيء فابكي للحسين. If you're going to cry for anything and for any reason, redefine the attention of your crying to cry for Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, the statement here is not to say cry for your own problems and then also remember to cry for Imam Hussein. It's not saying that. It's saying that you have a reason to cry. That means there's something that's caused your emotions to be excited, and your body naturally reacts in crying, shedding a tear. It's natural to do. The instruction the Imam gives, which is extremely delicate now, he says, change in that instant. That means your intention, what you're thinking about, the reason for your sorrow, in an instant, shift that from your problem, from your challenge, from your strife, from your grief, to the grief of Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam and his family. فَبْكِ لِلْحُسَيْنَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ فَإِنَّهُ ذُبِحَ كَمَا يُذْبَحُ الْكَبْشِ. We have problems. We have difficulties. Every mu'min will be tested. Every mu'min will be in a position of difficulty. But wherever you find yourself, just take one instant. If you've trained yourself well enough, take that one instant and just try to contrast that, juxtapose that with what Imam Hussein عليه الصلاة والسلام and his companions and his family and his progeny and the caravan all of them went through. There should be no reason for a person to truly cry for their own difficulties. If a tear is to be shed, it should be shed for Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. So this is the essence and the reality of what the Imams are trying to teach us, to connect with a truth that is so strong that it overtakes every aspect of a person's life. Now, in coming back to our engagement with the Imam, this is the experience that Jabir ibn Abdullah had with Atiyah and other individuals that went to the ziyarah of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. We are now afforded the opportunity as well, through instruction of Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, to recite the ziyarah of Arba'een. Now, ziyarah of Arba'een is a ziyarah that, you know, it resembles many other ziyarat that are recited from Imam Hussein. Essentially, none of them are going to be different. But like I said before, if we look to the actual tenth, the text, the content of what's being recited, and trying to compare that with now where we are, I think there's a lot to be learned from there. And I'm just going to share a few of the statements that we recited, either today or yesterday, in the recitation of Ziyarah of Arba'een. Now, like many of us know, of course, the instruction of the Ziyarah of Arba'een, specifically on the 40th, that we said is exclusive to Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, comes to us in a hadith that is narrated from Imam Al-Asqi alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajib. In which he states, علامات المؤمن خمس, that the signs of a believer is five things. Now, of course, obviously, it's not exclusive to say that the only signs of believers are these five things. But the Imam is now giving us tangible things, not to look to other people to see if they have it or not, although that may be one application of it, but more importantly, to look to ourselves. Easy things. You may say, ma'rifa, knowledge, gnosis. That's hard for me to gauge where I actually stand. How can I know what my love is for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam? It's hard for me to do that. But some of these alamat, some of these signs are very simple, they're very easy. That a mu'min, if they want to be a practicing true mu'min, they should have, among their signs should be these five things. Number one, salatu ihda wa khamsin. For them to recite 51 cycles of prayers a day. Right? So the 17 comes from the salat that are farida, everyone has to recite. And the 34 now come that are extra from that. So the mu'min takes, of course, the next step forward. Those 34 is something you have to work on. And start easy. Like, I'm a lazy person. Personally, I am. What's the easiest nafilah of these 34 that I can recite? It's the one after Isha prayer. Why? Because you can sit down and do it. It's only two rak'ah, you quickly do it. And then nawafil, you don't even have to recite the surah afterwards. And literally, in 15 seconds, you can do that. You start there, and then you gradually increase. Dhuhr, Asr, they're tough. You say, okay, well, 8 and 8, that's tough. I can't do that. But the two after Isha is very simple. I can start with that. So that's one alama. The second one was ziyaratul arba'een. Number two is a ziyarah that is performed on the day of arba'een. Wattakhattum fil yameen. For a person to wear a ring on their right hand. Now, interestingly, why does the Imam say the right hand? If we study the history of these things, there was a movement that started, like many of the innovations that started as you distance yourself from the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet, a lot of things changed. During the early in the Umayyad Caliphate, and they say in the books that this was a Sunnah that was started by Muawiyah alayhi anhu, that he began to wear the ring on his left hand. So specifically the Imam says here that the sign of the believer is not only to wear the ring, but for it to be on his right hand. Know that that person is cognizant of one of the Sunnahs of the Holy Prophet. So this was in preservation of the prophetic Sunnah. Number four, وَتَعْفِيرُ الْجَبِينَ, for a person to place their head on the earth, as they do in Salat, on the earth. So the muhr, the turba that we have, is again in following of the instruction in this hadith, of course, in other ahadith and in the Holy Quran as well. And finally, وَالْجَهْرُ بِبِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. And finally, for a person to openly and loudly recite the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, when specifically? So in Fajr prayer, in Maghrib prayer, in Isha prayer, you're already reciting it loudly. In Dhuhr and in Asr prayer, the first two raka'ah that the Fatiha has been recited, this is again amongst the prophetic sunnahs, that the Imams are giving instructions specifically to the believers. When you're doing Dhuhr and Asr prayers, in the first two raka'ah, recite your Bismillah loudly. That is a sign of a person who is a believer. And these are also signs that mu'mineen Shia would use to figure out whether a person was following the maktab of the Ahlul Bayt or not. These are very easy signs. That are, in any case, what we want to say from this is that among the five things that we said, the first one is a little tough, I'll admit. The second was Yara Arba'in that we all recited. It's not very long. So that's easy, just to do it on a, at least to perform the ritual, if you want to call it, on a superficial level, to read it is very simple. Number three, the ring is extremely simple. You don't have to, you just put it on and forget about it. The aqiq. Number four, to pray, we're already doing that with our prayer. And finally, two, the bismillah is not very difficult either. So these are easy alamat, easy signs and symbols that a person can have. Now, the ziyarah of arba'in. I just want to go on a short tangent here. And inshallah, we have time. I think it's important to, from time to time, to do this. Ziyarah of Arba'in is found where? It's instructed by Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam to one of his close companions, Safwan ibn Mahran al-Jammah. Okay, so he instructs the companion how to recite the Ziyarah of Arba'in. It's found in many books. Among those books is in Tahdhib al-Ahkam of Shaykh Tusi, of Misbah al-Mutahajjid of Shaykh Tusi, and Iqbal al-A'mal. Now, the tangent that I want to go on is just to quickly and very briefly survey the tradition and culture, the literary culture that we have within dua, hadith, ziyarah, specifically within the Imami tradition. What are those books? Now, the book that is most known, most common in today's engagement with dua and ziyarah is what? Is Mafatih al-Jinan, correct? Of Sheikh Abbas Qummi. When is Sheikh Abbas Qummi? And when was this book written? It's written a lot later. This is not the primary and predominant book that historically we have in the Imami tradition. There are many books that came before that. And those are the original books that we have, these ahadith with the chain of narrators returning to the Imam, and that's where we can actually verify the veracity of these du'as and the ziyarat. A lot of this has been studied. So I just want to mention a few of them to start from a point that is very close now to the time of our Imams and follow that tradition all the way to the time that right now we're engaging with the book of Mafatih al-Jinan. So, perhaps the most important of these books, not the first of them, but the most important of them, that many of the traditions that we have about the ziyarah of the Ahlul Bayt and of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam, is a book by the name of Kamil al-Ziyarat. Kamil al-Ziyarat is a book that has been written in the 4th century by a scholar known as Ibn Qulaway al-Qummi. Of course, his name is a lot longer, Sheikh Abu al-Qasim Ja'far ibn Muhammad ibn Ja'far ibn Musa ibn Masrur. He passed away in the year 367 after Hijrah. So 4th century after Hijrah. 4th century after Hijrah is extremely close to the time of the Imams. Why? Because when is the occultation of the Holy Imam of our time? 329 is when the grand occultation begins, Ghaybatul Kubra. So if Ibn Qulay Qummi has passed away 367, he was obviously living during the time of the Holy Imam of our time and during the time of his shorter occultation. So, Kamil al-Ziyarat that is written by Ibn Qulay Qummi, he's born in Qum, his birthday is not very known. He makes a number of different trips in trying to, of course, learn the hadith, learn the tradition of the Ahlul Bayt. And finally, he's buried in the Haram in Kazimiyyah. If anyone has done the Ziyarah in Kazimain, his grave is there alongside a number of other scholars. He's buried right next to Sheikh al-Mufid. If you enter from Bab al-Qibla, he's on the right side of the Dariq. He's there, and Shaykh al-Mufid is there, which is his most notable student. And on the other side, parallel to them, is also Khaja Nasiruddin Tusi. He's also buried parallel to him on the other side of the Dariq. So his teachers and his most notable teacher is now Shaykh al-Kulaini. We know Kulayni from where? He's the author of Al-Kafi, one of the four major and most important hadith books that we have in the Imami tradition. So Al-Kulayni is one of his instructors, Ibn Babawayh, the father of Shaykh As-Saduq, another of our grand scholars that has penned the second of the four hadith books that we have, Man La Yahdhuru Al-Faqih. He's also the teacher of him. Muhammad ibn Hassan ibn Safar, the author of Basar al-Darajat. These are all the instructors of Ibn Qulwayh Qummi. So after that now moves to Misbah al-Mutahajjid, Wasilah al-Mutaabbid. This is also a very important book that happens a little after the time of Ibn Qulwayh Qummi. And it's penned by Shaykh At-Tusi, which we of course are all familiar with. He's also called Shaykh al-Ta'ifa. That means he is the Shaykh, that means the elder of this clan, of this group, of this tradition almost. Shaykh Tusi passes away in the 5th century, 460 after Hijrah. So almost 100 years after. This is the next main book, and this is the next checkpoint essentially, that this culture of dua and ziyarat, people are turning to a book of Misbah al-Mutahajjid from Shaykh At-Tusi. Of course, his teachers include Shaykh Al-Mufid, Sayyid Murtada, the brother of Sayyid Radi, that is of course compiled the Nahj al-Balagha. And after Shaykh Al-Mufid, he assumes the marja'iyya of the Shi'as. And they say that he trained more than 300 mujtahids. Now, 300 mujtahids is really not a joke. It's not a very simple thing. To train to be a mujtahid itself is an accomplishment. To train one mujtahid is an accomplishment. To train more than 300, and they say, not only from the Imami tradition of madhab, but also from Sunni madhab as well. He trained mujtahids as well, Shaykh At-Tusi. Among the most important books that he has, of course, like we said, Misbah al-Mutahajjid. He also has Al-Istibsar and Tahdhib al-Ahkam. These are the final two books in the four main hadith literature that we have. Not exclusive, but the four main ones. The four most important ones that every follower of the Shia, Imami, Madhab needs to know them. Needs to at least know their names, need to know who wrote them. And if their interest is piqued, then they should also read a little bit about who these are, why they wrote these books, what is in them, what importance it has in our time, in our day. This is extremely important. This idea of identity, to know what is our tradition. Many of us don't know. I can say with some confidence that many followers of the Ahlul Bayt know more books that have been written by scholars from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah than they know of the books that are written by followers of the Ahlul Bayt. I say this with some confidence. If I ask you to name books in hadith, many people read Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, and the 6 Sunan. Name one book of hadith from the Imami tradition. If anything, someone will say Baharul Anwar, for sure. Baharul Anwar, it's one of the grandest, if not the greatest, and the lengthiest compilation of hadith that we have. That's fine. What about earlier than that? So these four. Make an effort. These are things that I'm telling you. These are things that before going and studying, I'd never heard these things. Not like it wasn't mentioned. Not like I'd never, not that it none of it ever clicked. None of it ever registered. I never knew that something like this was important. What is Al-Kafi? I don't know. Who is Sheikh Saduq? I don't know. And why are they important to my age and my struggles? They're extremely important, but only when we engage. So if I can make a humble request as a brother of yours, that I was in a worse position than you are, and I still am. But after having just engaged a little bit with these books, really it not only brings me a sense of confidence and identity, but it allows me the opportunity to become humble. The humility that comes with all of the work that our scholars have done to help us arrive at this point. We would know nothing of what happened in Karbala on the year 61 after Hijrah, if not for people who took it upon themselves to share this legacy with us. And who began that? The Ahlul Bayt themselves. So this is following in the legacy and the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt. If Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam, if Zainab Kubra alayhi salatu wasalam didn't take it upon themselves from the first days to gather people and tell them, this is what happened to us, we would never know. Perhaps many of us would also celebrate the day of Ashura as a day of celebration, as many in the Muslim community do. Not because they have any animosity, it's just that they don't know. No one has told them. So imagine how much of our tradition is there, but for whatever reason, we don't know about it, we're not engaging. This is something that all of us, We need to take it upon ourselves to try and make an effort. Yes, the resources are not available, but to make an effort to read and study as much as we can to our own extent. The barakah will come from a person doing that. That sincere intention will bring so much that is lost on a person who is completely, you know, oblivious to these things. In any case, let's move forward. I'll just quickly name the names of the book. Number three is Al-Iqbal Bil-A'mal Al-Hasana by Sayyid Ibn Tawus, of course, that is well known as the book of Iqbal Al-A'mal. The main name of the book is Al-Iqbal Bil-A'mal Al-Hasana Fima U'malu Marratan Fis-Sana. It means for a person to essentially turn to the righteous acts that are to be performed at least once a year. So this is written by Sayyid Ibn Tawus. Sayyid Ibn Tawus is, of course, we know him from where? His other main writing, entitled Al-Luhuf or Al-Malhuf, correct? This is one of those original or traditional accounts of what happened in Karbala. That story is narrated in Al-Luhuf. Many of us have heard the account of what happened before, during the day, and after from the account that Sayyid Ibn Tawus, of course, he compiles in his Al-Luhuf. After that, Sayyid Ibn Tawus is in the 7th century, dies in 664. Then Uddatu Da'i wa Najahu Sa'i, a book written by Ibn Fahd Hilli. Interestingly, before the program, I saw in this in the books that were here, that book is there. It's translated into English. Uddatu Da'i. It's one of the most famous books that now in the 9th century that Ibn Fahd Hilli pens. He dies in 841. It's a very important book and a very profound book as well. He was a student of the first martyr, Shahid al-Abwal, as we call Muhammad ibn Makki, and Fakhr al-Muhaqqiqin, the son of Allamay Hilli. And he has, of course, other important books as well. Number four now, Junnatul Aman wa Baqayatu wal-Waqiya wa Junnatul Iman wal-Baqiya. This is also known as Misbah of Al-Kaf'ami, written by Ibrahim ibn Ali ibn Kaf'ami, 10th century, dies in 905. This is the next book. This is a very important book. Al-Misbah is known. Not to be confused with Misbah al-Mutahajjid of Sheikh Tusi, like we said. But these are also very two important books. Sheikh Abbas Qomi, when he's writing this, Mafatih al-Jannah, is drawing from these books of hadith. Again, I'll just kind of move forward because we don't have time. The final three of them. One is Miftah al-Falah, written by Sheikh Bahai in the 11th century. He passes away, 1031. And then after that, we have Zadul Ma'ad, that's written by Allama Majlisi, Muhammad Taqi Majlisi, the son. And that's written, of course, in the 12th century. He dies 1110, in the Safavid period. And finally, now we have Mafatih al-Jinan. That's penned by Sheikh Abbas al-Qumi, and he passes away, of course, in the 14th century, 1359. So very close to our times, less than 100 years ago, 1359 now. So the tradition that we have of these hadith, and even this ziyara that we have, we pick up the Mafatih, we look at it. This has a very long tradition that reaches not only the time of the Ahlul Bayt, but within the early tradition of the scholars. Recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Okay, we're running out of time, and I'll try to share the remaining of my points very concisely. So, in reciting the ziyarah and in performing the ziyarah is really not something to be recited. The ziyarah is something to be performed. This is another thing that's sometimes lost on us, on someone like me. Because they say, perform the ziyarah of Imam Hussain alayhi salam by reading this. So I think the ziyarah is simply a recitation. It's not. It's an engagement with the Imam, as I do when I'm in the presence of his haram. So to do it from a distance is a mercy and a blessing that we've been afforded, because we don't have the opportunity to go and do the ziyarah from a close every time that we want to do the ziyarah of the Imam. So we're afforded the opportunity to do that from afar. So this is a blessing. Now a person should try and go as frequent as they can. In some hadith we have, if a person is a Shia of ours and does not perform the ziyarah of Imam Hussain once in his lifetime, then he should not consider himself a Shia, number one. Number two, if someone lives in close proximity and doesn't do it frequently, then the person should also look to their belief, their iman, with suspicion. Many accounts of people coming to the Ahlul Bayt, even during the time of Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, where are you coming from? He said, I live close to Karbala. He says that, you know, I came to you, Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, so I had questions, I had requests, I have hajat. I'm coming to you, help me with them. He says, you came to someone when you had a person more qualified and more suitable close to you? So even to a person coming in the presence of the Imam of their time, Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam says, Imam Hussain alayhi salam is there, go there. What you're looking for is to be found there. So the ziyarah is an action to be performed and to be engaged. Now, in the ziyarah of Arba'een, there's so many rewards that are written for a person who does the ziyarah. So anyone who does the ziyarah of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam is like a person who has performed the hajj with the Prophet. One. And then they say, perform two hajj with the Prophet, three hajj. Even we have hadith from the Prophet himself. During the youth of the life of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam, one of his wives asked him that, you know, why do you love this son so much? And he says, this is what's going to happen to him. And anyone who does the ziyarah of him and goes to his grave is like has performed hajj with me, and he continues all the way into 90 hajj, as if he has done 90 hajj with me during my life. Now, so the ziyarah has great rewards. But what is really the true essence? That means what is that critical factor that is found within ziyarah that defines it as a successful experience? So what is that ideal, if you want to call it? I don't like this word of ideal. But in any case, what is the ideal ziyarah? What is that ideal experience supposed to be? And I want to draw on the ziyarah of Arba'een that we read, because these are the statements that we've made and we continue to make. One of those statements is this. It's a short ziyarah, of course we know. Allahumma inni ushiduka anni waliyun liman wala wa aduun liman aada bi abi anta wa ummi yabna rasulillah. Says, Allahumma, O Allah, ushiduka, you be my witness, anni waliyun liman, that I made friends with the people that Imam Hussain alayhi salam made friends with. And I made enemies with the person that Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam and his companions made enemies with. You be my witness, O Allah. That means a person has that much confidence in their conduct, in their position, in their actions, that he makes such a profound statement. Now link this back to the experience that Jabir ibn Abdullah had in the first Arba'een. He says, I know because I'm so confident of my intention and I'm so confident of my deeds that I can make a statement like that. We are essentially repeating the statement that Jabir is making as a highly respected and a close companion of the Ahlul Bayt and the Holy Prophet. He comes with that confidence. We also, being a companion, we come with this confidence as well. But like we said, the two reflection points, with how much love are we coming and how certain of our intentions and our deeds are we? We further state, وَأَشْهَدُ أَنِّي بِكُمْ مُؤْمِنْ وَبِإِيَابِكُمْ. And, O Allah, I declare without any doubt, positively, that I have full faith in you, the Ahlul Bayt, and I have full faith in your return. مُوقِنٌ بِشَرَائِعِ دِينِي مُوقِنْ يَقِينِ. I have full confidence, I have certainty in the tenets and in the laws of my religion. وَخَوَاتِيمِ عَمَلِي. And in the seal of my deeds. Notice the statement that we're saying that, Allah, I am so confident in my religion, there is nothing in my religion that I feel unclear about, unsure about. That's what we were saying, and that's what we said. Now, a person like me has to ask myself, truly, how much confidence do I have in the laws of my religion? The point here is not to say, well, whether the law is right or not. I don't want to nitpick specific cases of, well, in this law, I'm actually not sure. Actually, the fuqaha, the jurists don't even know. That's not the point. The grander system of what this sharia is, how much confidence do I have in that? And that confidence now is declared in the next statement, that I have full confidence in my own deeds as well. Not only do I have confidence in the sharia, because I've understood it so well. Look, a person can't make a statement like this when they're oblivious to the law, when they're oblivious to the tradition, when they're oblivious to the religion and the religious tenets. A person can't make a statement so positively and so strongly and then follow with, you know, I'm very confident about my actions and my deeds. وَقَلْبِي لِقَلْبِكُمْ سِلْمٍ. My heart is at peace with you. وَأَمْرِي لِأَمْرِكُمْ مُتَّبِعٍ. And my affairs are based off of your commands and based off of your instruction. And essentially what I'm saying here is that my understanding of my religion is so strong My actions are so strong. And what actually guides what I do and don't do is based on your command at the attribute. This shows a living connection and instruction that is being received from the Imam. That means it's difficult for a person to make this statement without actually feeling like they are engaged now, really, with the Imam of their time. It's hard for a person to do that. اللهم صل على محمد ونصرة لكم معدة حتى يأذن الله لكم فمعكم معكم لو مع عدوكم. And my support for you is already and all set. Essentially, I'm waiting for your next command. Until Allah gives you the permission, so I am with you, and I am with you, and I'm not with your enemies. Okay, so to conclude, tonight, inshallah, what we'll do is we'll continue tomorrow night, is that if the day of Arba'in is going to be the start of the next cycle, it means it's the end of this first cycle, this 40 days, what has been accomplished, number one, needs to be assessed. There needs to be a study and a reflection, personally, individually, of what was done, what was accomplished. And the second point is that now how am I supposed to move forward? How much do I right now feel confident about a statement like this? Should that mean that I shouldn't make a statement like this? Quran says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَا تَغُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Why do you say things that you don't do? Okay. Allah doesn't like that. كَبُرُ مَقْتَنَ عَلَى اللَّهِ أَن تَغُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Allah does not like that. So the point is here, should we kind of go away from the Imam until we fix it? No. In an engagement of this ziyarah, a person is building themselves, they're training themselves to perform that ziyarah that now in the hadith, and I'll end with this inshallah, the reward that is defined, the highest reward. And it's really not, you know, the hadith are not hyperboles. Many people look to hadith tradition and say, you know what, they're hyperbolic. They say things that are obviously not true, or they're just trying to say things to encourage us to do them. Let me share a hadith with you that one of the ashab asked from Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. He says, قُلْتُ جُعِلْتُ فِدَاكَ ما لمن أتى قبر الحسين زائرا له عارفا بحقه يريد به وجه الله والدار الآخرة. He asks him, if a person goes to ziyarah with these conditions, he does the ziyarah and he has these two qualities, he's عارفا بحقه, he fully understands the right and the truth of the Imam, and he's going there seeking his hereafter. The Imam responds, يَا هَارُونَ مَنْ أَتَى قَبْرَ الْحُسَيْنَ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامِ زَائِرًا لَهُ عَارِفًا بِحَقِّهِ يُرِيدُ بِهِ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Allah will forgive his sins, those which were before him and those which will follow. The person says, that's not fair. How is Allah going to forgive your sins that you haven't even done yet? This is where, you know, the Imami tradition, this is where, you know, they're out of blind here. They're saying things that are obviously contradict with the Quranic teaching. How can Allah forgive you for the sins that you haven't even performed yet? The point here is that if a person comes with that irfan, that knowledge of the truth and the reality of the Imam, one of two things will happen. Either a person will not sin after that, no reason to forgive. Or if a person does, they are so conscious of their action that a person will quickly repent. And the ghufran that happens is a result of a person's consciousness. Let's end tonight with a few minutes of the recitation of Musiba of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam. You know, nights like these are numbered now. You know, with the Arba'in passing, many of us, like we mentioned, we feel like until next year, you know, we've done our part, we've done our duty. And when Muharram begins next year is when we will revisit the struggle, the journey, the martyrdom of Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam, and also the companions and the caravan. But really this struggle doesn't end on the night like Arba'in. In many ways it's just beginning. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. وعجل فرجهم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم.
السلام على ولي الله وحبيبه السلام على خليل الله ونجيبه السلام على سفي الله وابن سفيه السلام على الحسين المظلوم الشهيد السلام على أسير الكربات وقتيل العبرات Peace be upon you, the intimate servant of Allah and His most beloved. Peace be upon you, O the friend of Allah and His elite. Peace be upon you, the chosen of Allah and the son of His chosen. Peace be upon you, O Hussein, the wronged and the martyr. Peace be upon the captive of agonies and victim of the shed tears. They say on the day of Arba'een, the 40th day now, the records are different, but they say that the Ahlul Bayt now either began their journey from Damascus or returned to Medina. In beginning their journey from Damascus back to Medina, Imam Zainul Abideen, Lady Zainab Salamullah Alayha, and the remaining of the companions in the caravan, day after day after day, they're getting closer and closer to returning to their home in Medina. But they bring with them a tragedy that now the people of Medina have heard, but not in the greatest of detail. As the caravan nears the outskirts of Medina, Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salatu wassalam stops the caravan and erects a tent. And he addresses one of the companions, Bashir ibn Hadlam, says, "Oh Bashir, your father was a poet. May Allah have mercy on him. Are you also able to recite poetry?" Bashir responded, "Yes, O my master. O son of the Holy Prophet, I too am a poet and can recite poetry." The Imam responds and instructs Bashir, says, "Go into the city now of Medina and announce the martyrdom of Abu Abdullah alayhi salatu wassalam." Bashir says, "I rode on a horse and rushed to enter Medina. When I reached the mosque of the Holy Prophet, I raised my weeping voice and recited this poetry. Ya ahla Yathrib la muqama lakum biha. قتل الحسين فأدمعي مدرار الجسم منه بكربلاء مدرج والرأس منه على القناة تدار O people of Medina, Medina is no more your place. Hussein has been killed, making me weep all the time. His bleeding body was left in Karbala, and his holy head was moved from place to place on a spear." Bashir says, "Thereafter I said, Zainul Abideen alayhi salam, who has come near to Medina, is with his aunts and sisters. I am his messenger informing you of his arrival. It is said that all the ladies and veiled women came out with unveiled faces and bare heads, and they scratched their faces and slapped their cheeks. They wept loudly in mourning. After the death of the Holy Prophet, it was not seen so much weeping in Medina." They said, one of these women turned to Bashir and said, "O messenger of doom, you have renewed our grief by the news of the martyrdom of Abu Abdullah. You have put salt on our wounds, which we were not yet healed. May Allah have mercy on you. Who are you?" He responded, "I am Bashir ibn Hadlam. My master Ali ibn al-Husayn alayhi salam has sent me, and he is in such and such a place with his family members." He said, "People rushed to the outskirts of Medina." Bashir says, "I quickly drove my horse after to reach them. When I arrived at the tent of the holy imams, the people had surrounded him and the roads were jammed. I dismounted my horse and went to the holy imam with my foot. Imam Zainul Abideen was sitting in the tent, and the imam then exited with a handkerchief in his hand, wiping his tears with it. A servant was holding a chair behind the imam. He then placed a chair on the ground and the Imam sat on it. He was not able to prevent his tears from rolling down his holy eyes. The voice of the weeping men and women rent the whole atmosphere. Everyone from every side was consoling the Imam. It seemed that a place of the earth had turned into a mourning land. Then the Imam signals with his hand for silence. All of the people stopped weeping and listened to the Imam. Then the Imam began reciting his sermon, which can be seen as the first musiba recited for the people of Medina. The Imam begins, فَقَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the most merciful and the most beneficent. بارئ الخلاق أجمعين الذي بعد فارتفع في السماوات العلا وقرب فشهد النجوى. The Imam continues, نحمده على عدائم الأمور. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over the great affairs. وفجائع الدهور, over the tragedies of the time. وألم الفجع ومضادة اللوادي. And we praise him over the bitterness of scoldings and over crushing difficulties and hardship. وجليل الرزع وعديم المصائب الفاضعة الكاذة الفادحة الجائحة. أيها القوم, O people, إن الله وله الحمد. Indeed, Allah and all praise belongs to him. ابتلانا بمصائب جليلة. Allah has tried us with a great affliction. وَثُلْمَةٍ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ عَظِيمًا. And a schism and split in Islam. قُتِلْ أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الْحُسَيْنِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ وَعِتْرَتِهِ. They have martyred Abu Abdullah and his household and his companions. وَالسُّبِيَ نِسَاؤُهُ وَسَبِيَّتُهُ. And they imprisoned his wives and his daughters. وداروا برأسه في البلدان من فوق عام السنان. And they carried his holy head on a spear from place to place. وهذه الرزية التي ليس مثلها رزية. And so this is a calamity that was truly unparalleled. أيها الناس فأي رجالات منكم يسرون بعد غدله. O people, now among you, which of your men can ever be joyous after this? أم أي فؤاد لا يحزن من أجله. Who is able to stop their tears from rolling down their cheeks? أم أي عين منكم تحبس دمعها وتذن عن إهمالها. And who can stop their eyes from weeping and be stingy in their tears? فَلَقَدْ بَكَتِ السَّبْعُ الشِّدَادُ لِقَتْلِهِ. Truly the seven heavens wept over his martyrdom. وَبَكَتِ الْبِحَارُ بِأَمْوَاجِهَا. And the oceans wept through their waves. وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ بِأَرْكَانِهَا. And the skies with their pillars. وَالْأَرْضُ بِأَرْجَائِهَا. And the earth with its tracks. وَالْأَشْجَارُ بِأَغْصَانِهَا. والحيتان لجج البحار والملائكة المقربون وأهل السماوات أجمعون. The trees with their branches, the fish in the depths of the seas, all of the angels and all of the heavens became tearful. The Imam then continues to truly highlight what was the most sorrowful and tragic of their events. أيها الناس أي قلب لا ينصدع لقتله. O people, which heart is so hard that has not been shocked by his martyrdom? أم أي فؤاد لا يحن إلي. And which soul has not been inclined towards Hussein after this? أم أي سمع يسمع هذه الثلمة التي ثلمت في الإسلام ولا يسوم. Which ear has been deafened after hearing this blow on Islam? أيها الناس, O people, أصبحنا مترودين مشردين مذودين وشاسعين عن الأمصار. O people, we spent in such a condition that we were expelled, we were scattered, we were driven off in every way from city and villages. As if we were slaves, that's how they treated us. In Ziyarat al-Nahya we recite, Wasubiya ahluka kal'abid, and your family were captured like slaves. وَسُفِّدُوا فِي الْحَدِيدِ فَوْقَ أَقْدَامِ الْمَطِيَّاتِ, and they were bound with iron chains atop camels. تَلْفَحُوا وُجُوهَهُمْ هَرُّ الْهَاجِرَاتِ, with the midday heat scorching their faces. يُسَاقُونَ فِي الْبَرَارِ وَالْفَلَوَاتِ, they were driven across the deserts and the wastelands. أَيْدِيهِمْ مَغْلُولَةٌ إِلَى الْأَعْنَاقِ, their hands were chained to their necks. يُطَافُ بِهِمْ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ, they were paraded around the markets. Oh people, this is how they treated us and this caravan. مِنْ غَيْرِ جُرْمٍ اجْتَرَمْنَاهُ, without any fault of ours. وَلَا مَكْرُوهٍ ارْتَكَبْنَاهُ, وَلَا ظُلْمَةٍ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ ظَلَمْنَاهُ, not any mistake of ours, nor any harm that we had performed towards Islam. مَا سَمِعْنَا بِهَذَا فِي آبَائِنَا الْأَوَّلِينَ, we had not heard such a thing in our predecessors. إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا اخْتِلَاقٌ, this is truly something that is new that has befell us. And this is how the Imam ends and concludes his first musibah. وَاللَّهُ لَوْ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ تَقَدَّمَ إِلَيْهِمْ فِي قِتَالِنَا كما تقدم إليهم في الوصايا بنا. By Allah, if even the Holy Prophet had encouraged his nation to declare war against us instead of the recommendations that he gave for us. والله لو أن النبي تقدم إليهم في القتال لما زادوا على ما فعلوا بنا, even if the Prophet had encouraged war against us, we would not have been treated worse than we were treated in this journey. فَإِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ مَا أَعْذَمَهَا وَأَوْجَعَهَا وَأَفْجَعَهَا وَأَكَذَّهَا وَأَفْضَعَهَا وَأَمَرَّهَا وَأَفْدَاحَهَا, فَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ نَهْدَسُ فِينَا أَصَابَنَا وما بلغ بنا فإنه عزيز ذو انتقام. ألا نعنة الله على القوم الظالمين, وسلام الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم العظيم العزيز الجل الأكرم, إلهي بحق الحسين. يا الله 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 يا رحمن يا رحيم, يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك, واكفنا يا قاضي الحاجات ويا كافي المهمات, إنك مجيب الدعوات, إنك على كل شيء قدير. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج, اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج, اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج والعافية والنصر, وجعلنا من خير أنصاره وعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. يا الله, we ask on a night like this, in which we are commemorating the Arba'een of Aba Abdullah alayhi salatu wasalam, hasten the reappearance of the Holy Imam. Ya Allah, we ask on a night like this, afford us the opportunity to look inwardly, reflect on our conduct, in our intentions, in our relationship with the Holy Imam Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, his companions, his progeny, but more importantly, the Holy Imam of our time. May Allah hasten his reappearance. Ya Allah, we ask you to protect us, to protect our children. Allah, we ask you to give good health and speedy recovery to all of those who are ill. Ya Allah, we ask you to bless all of our deceased. Ya Allah, we ask you to make us on the right path, to protect us and to protect our families. Amin ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi at-tahirin. Salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.